Today is a painful day for the Yazidis of Kurdistan. It's the third anniversary of the genocide of their people. On August 3rd, 2014, fighters from ISIS, or Daesh as they're called in Arabic, invaded the Sinjar region in northern Iraq, the ancestral home of the Yazidi minority. Some 200,000 Yazidis fled to Sinjar. As many as 4,400 were massacred, and another 4,000 to 10,000 were kidnapped, forced to convert to Islam, tortured, and sold into slavery. Those who escaped are now scattered across Kurdistan, living in refugee camps. Today, they mark the beginning of their fourth year in exile. Some are weeping. Most are silent. All of them are wondering when the world will take notice. Standing with them is an Israeli woman who has dedicated her life to helping them however she can.
Who wants to intervene with a persecuted, unknown minority group in the Middle East? My conscience will not let me sit at home. Although out of my depth more than ever, I said I cannot walk away. Why the Yazidis? I ask myself questions and I don't have answers. The roots of Springs of Hope are really deep in the Intifada of Jerusalem, where my eldest son in 1998 was serving as an army officer in Beit El on the borders of Ramallah. He came home from the base one day, took a lift with a civilian who had been working on the base, and they ran into a group of 20 to 30 Hamas students who had been lying in wait for 2 hours waiting to kill an Israeli soldier, and that happened to be my son. Now, really thanks to the goodness of God, my son was not killed. I got a phone call to say he was in the operating theater of Hadassah Ein Kerem, beaten to a pulp. Just about every bone in his body was either broken or fractured. They tried to pull out his eyes, broken his skull, and overnight, in 1 second, as happens to every terror survivor, terror walked into our house and our life changed.
4 years later, Lisa's son was in yet another terror attack. This time, a suicide bombing in Jerusalem's Cafe Moment. He survived, but 11 others were killed.
It was within a couple of years that my kids had been in other terror attacks in Jerusalem. And I felt a rage inside me. I think there's something in me that says, the milk is spilled, now how are we gonna clean it up? And on the basis of conscience screaming, do something, I grabbed friends and grabbed a lawyer. And I said, this is Springs of Hope Foundation. And we just jumped in with the terror survivors of Jerusalem.
It was here in the Sharia refugee camp that Lisa got her first look at the women who had been kidnapped by ISIS.
We had worked since 2002 with victims of terror in Jerusalem, specifically widows and the younger kids that had fallen between the cracks. I had also been doing research for many years on the global funding of terror. It was 6 months after the beginning of the Yazidi genocide in Sinjar and Shingal, 3rd of August 2014. I begged, insisted, pleaded that we come up here, drove up to Sharia camp, walked around Sharia camp, flew back to Israel, and I was wrecked. I was just undone. I think I just jumped in pretty stupidly without knowing what I was jumping into and realized that we had, as Israel, a small role to play regarding the women and the kids who are coming out of Daesh. I went into Sharia camp, which was then 22,000 and bursting at the seams, totally overwhelmed. If the UN can't cope, who are we to even dare to think that we can, you know, a drop in the bucket? But when I began to meet the women that were coming out of Daesh and helping to take off their black robes and shower them and put a new dress on them, I realized that here we could help, and that would be our place of tikkun olam.
From the beginning, Lisa made it a point to identify herself as Jewish.
If I cannot live as a Jew, and if I cannot be here as an Israeli, I cannot be here. I cannot hide or deny who I am, and I believe it's because we're a Jew and we were called to be a light to the world. That's the reason I'm here. That's the reason I'm here. And for me, with the background of terrorism and trauma, Israel is the lead in the world. So if I'm going to hide this, then I'd rather stay at home and have an espresso and hang out with my friends and with my kids.
One of Lisa's biggest challenges is knowing how to help the women and children who have witnessed so much horror.
I mean, I've learned now, I know nothing. I come in here knowing I know nothing, because every time I think I've seen all and heard all, there's worse, there's worse, there's worse, there's worse, there's worse.
I was in captivity for 1 year and 3 months. Before the genocide, I was married with 2 children and another one on the way. Our life was good, and my husband and I were very happy together. We were not rich, but we had everything we needed. At 2 a.m. on August 3rd, ISIS attacked our village. We couldn't move because their forces were fighting on both sides of our house. In the morning, we tried to escape to the mountains, but they caught us 3 hours later. They took us to Seba Sheikh Khadir, where we spent 2 days. There, they separated all of us, and our lives changed in a moment. After that, they moved us to a jail in Badush. We spent a week in jail with no food and no water. Sometimes they came in the middle of the night and beat the children. They shouted at us and told us not to let the children sleep. After that, they took us to the city of Raqqa in Syria, where ISIS was in control.
At 9 months pregnant, Zeri was taken to a slave market run by ISIS. There, she gave birth to her baby. But after being sold to a Syrian man, she was forced to leave the baby behind with a friend.
They treated us in a brutal way. In Syria, they gave me to 6 different men. They did things with us that you cannot even imagine. My children and I were in a terrible situation in a strange country.
After more than a year in slavery, Zeri and her children were rescued. She doesn't want to be identified because her husband is still in captivity, and she doesn't even know if he's still alive. Today, Zeri and her children live in a home for Yazidi women, and they get help with food, clothing, and whatever else they need from Springs of Hope.
I met her the day she came back again, took off the black clothes, put new clothes on her. We had bags of clothes and goods for her and the kids. Her eyes were sad. She was lifeless. And there's still a sadness, but there's also a life in her today. There's the ability to hug her. The kids come and they jump on your lap. They hug you, they kiss you. They've come a long way, a long way.
Lisa visited me a lot and brought medicine for me. Whenever she came, she brought clothes for my kids and gave us money. I'm so thankful for her kindness to us. But not only to us. She is good to all of the Yazidi people like me. She gives her very best for us. May God bless her always.
In addition to women, ISIS routinely targets young children. Yazidi boys are kidnapped, forced to convert to Islam, and trained to make bombs, use weapons, and fight like adult soldiers. They've become known as the cubs of the caliphate.
Thomas.
My name is Thomas Abdullah. I am 11 years old.
Thomas was kidnapped by ISIS when he was just 8.
They took me to Mosul. They were telling us to shut up all the time. They taught me how to use a shotgun, a rocket launcher, bombs, a bazooka and other kind of weapons. It made me feel bad.
He wore a suicide belt every day. He was trained with RPGs, all the types of weapons and rifles and guns, everything he knows. He's a soldier. The same as the majority of the boys that are coming out, they're soldiers. And when they had a day off, they were forced to do hard labor in the kitchens.
My job there was washing dishes. There were three of us. One boy died, but the other boy and I stayed alive. They made us learn the Quran, and they told us, you must pray.
When American-led forces bombed Mosul, Tomas's captors fled for their lives. He was trapped under the wreckage of a building with two broken legs, and later found by Iraqi forces.
They asked me, are you Yazidi? I said yes, and they picked me up and gave me food and water. Later on, they took me to the hospital, and my father came and picked me up.
For months before that, Lisa had been working with local rescuers to reunite Tomas with his family.
The rescuer called me and said, Tomas is on his way out. He's been discovered in Mosul, buried under rubble. I said, we'll adopt him. Send me Tomas's picture, we'll find someone for him.
I was always thinking of coming back to my home. I knew that one day I would be free and meet my family again. It was such a nice feeling when I got back home. Someday in the future, I want to become part of the Kurdish army so I can help destroy ISIS.
Tomas's reunion with his family was bittersweet. One of his sisters is still in captivity.
The sad thing, the sad, tragic thing about this Tomas's story is that I asked Abdullah, what about his other daughter? Do you have any info? He said, yes, Tomas was with her just last week, but she told him she could have come out with Tomas and she chose to stay with Daesh. Why? The brainwashing of Mosul is this total genocide. Genocide means stripping a person through brainwashing primarily of their identity.
On August 3rd, ISIS took women and men of all ages, and they were screaming for help. To protect ourselves, we worked as their slaves for 2 or 3 years, so they wouldn't kill us. We gave up, and we converted our religion to Islam.
There was an airstrike, and Feroz was literally slit from this bone, the collarbone, down to her pelvic area, burnt all down here, shrapnel all over.
I was injured when the planes attacked the house we were in. I have had 4 surgeries. Most of the time, I'm too scared to go out because I remember being hit by the bombs.
She had held it together for 2 years and say 10 months. And then she comes to a tent. She's got no home. It's gone. She comes to this tent with nothing but a UN mattress, and that is it. She was in very deep depression. So we just go, give her support, financial support, give them food, give them clothes. We took them shopping to buy them new dresses. And just be there. Bring footballs for the kids. Just be there.
My life here in this camp is so bad. We cannot live this way. Until now, nobody visits or helps us with anything, except for Springs of Hope, which has done a lot for us.
We immediately began to take her out of the camp 3 days a week for maybe 2-3 hours. To volunteer with us, to get her out of just sitting and thinking and weeping. We got her out, got her to give to others, got her to come over. Every Saturday night we have a workshop in our volunteers' home in the Hope House. So she began to come to that and serve the chai and serve the coffee and serve the juice and serve the cake. And just gradually draw her out and draw her into helping others. And she's actually doing very well.
Lisa helped me with the treatments and medicines. And I healed so much faster from my surgeries. It means a lot to me. Lisa has done a lot of things for us. And I will never ever forget her until I die.
The women who don't escape are often put up for auction to help pay for the Islamic State's war. They are auctioned off online and even on social media for thousands of dollars. But thanks to one man, these auctions have become a means of rescue for many Yazidi girls. Abdullah Shrem is a Yazidi businessman who operates a team of smugglers throughout the Middle East.
There was a period of time where he would be getting all the pictures on WhatsApp of the young Yazidi girls, 11 years old, 12 years old, 13 years old, who would be put onto the sabaya, onto the slave market in Raqqa the next day.
For Abdullah, it's a very personal mission.
On August 3rd, 2014, the Islamic State attacked the Sinjar region and we escaped. They took 56 members of my family.
Abdullah's sister was one of the 56. She managed to get in touch with him from behind enemy lines.
I felt hopeless because no one, not even the Iraqi government, would help rescue the Yazidi people. So I thought, I am the only one who can help them. I would have never, ever thought of doing this. But when the girls called us from inside Syria begging for help, we felt that we should stand up and help them. At that time, I was a businessman in Aleppo, so I used my business to help get those girls back. The first thing that I did was start buying cigarettes in bulk, because cigarettes are forbidden by the leaders of ISIS. So I traded cigarettes with the lower level soldiers in exchange for getting our women back. Then we opened a shop for children's clothes so the Syrian mothers would come and shop. That way we could get information from the women about where our Yazidi girls were.
Abdullah also opened a small bakery and sent messages inside loaves of bread.
Every rescued girl had a different sad story. But I always remember one story that affected me the most. There was a woman raising four children, three boys and one girl. The girl was 8, and the boys were 3, 1, and 6 months old. They were kidnapped along with her. Once she tried to escape, but the ISIS soldiers caught her and punished her. They poisoned all her children, and they died right in front of her eyes. The same ISIS member who killed her children raped her all the time. It was the most painful story that I've ever heard.
Abdullah has spent his entire life savings rescuing Yazidi women from slavery. But still, he refuses to quit.
Many people have told me that ISIS is keeping photos of me on a kill list. 3 times ISIS members sent me pictures of myself. They told me that they are following me and that they will kill me. Many people have asked me, aren't you afraid to keep doing this? I'm not afraid, because if a 14-year-old girl is being raped in front of my eyes, for sure, my life is not as important as one of her tears. I've been doing this job for 3 years, and I have rescued 354 people. Neither the Kurdish nor the Iraqi government gave us any help. I will not give up until I get all those girls out of there, because their lives are more important than mine. When Lisa first came to Dahuk, she cried when she met me, and she said, I promise I will do whatever I can to make something good for the children you are rescuing.
When these women come out, or these kids come out, we will sponsor them. We'll come and we'll meet them, we'll take care of their immediate needs, and I'll find sponsors for them.
Once the women and children are reunited with their families, Lisa and her team help with food, medical care, and counseling. Every week, they also hold what they call Giving Day, where they distribute bags of food, clothing, and supplies in various camps, like this one in Kardia. They also opened two community centers where both Muslim and Yazidi children learn and play together.
If we say we are doing trauma therapy, nobody will come. It's a society that is based on honor. The shame, disgrace is very, very strong. So if you say trauma, you're adding stigma. Nobody would want to be seen to go into a trauma center. So we have two community centers that do art therapy, music therapy, drama therapy, English, and computer sciences. That's what we do at the moment.
This life is war, and it's too hard. Mrs. Lisa has come here to give us amazing hope. Mrs. Lisa gives them amazing happiness and other things they need. The love, the hope, other things, the smile. And now all of we have amazing hope in this life.
We love you, we love you, we love you, Lisa.
Today, the parents are here to watch their children put on a small concert.
Every Friday night, we have an ice cream party in our house for a whole bunch of kids from Daesh. We sugar them up. They're probably crazy afterwards. But we sugar them up with ice cream and Coca-Cola. We talk, we laugh, they play on the trampoline. We take them outside, we play football. They draw pictures. I assess where they're at. We listen to the parents. We listen to the extended family to be close and to see and to figure out, okay, this is where they're at, so this is the next step. This is what we do now. Or this is what we try to do now.
I have seen the love from the Springs of Hope Foundation when they give toys to all the poor and displaced children to make them happy. I really appreciate them and thank Lisa and her team for what they are doing. Many of the refugee children here think of Lisa as if she's their mother. Many organizations have come and gone in Kurdistan, but Lisa is very special because she's always giving her best to the people, and I love her dearly.
Today, 1,500 Yazidi women and children remain in captivity. And more than 400,000 are refugees who need critical help.
So where is the world? Where are the Jewish communities that understand that we are our brother's keeper? Where are they? Where are the Christian communities that know exactly the same? Where are they? I've given up on governments, but where are people who can help? You can no longer say, I don't know. There is blood on our hands if we know and we walk away. And I always go back to that verse in Bereshit in Genesis. The voices of our brothers' blood are crying out. And what are we as Jews and Christians doing? I am an observant Jew. I love my faith and I love my God. I have three kids and three grandkids and one grandkid about to be born. I should be with them. And I always come back to, you know, what are you doing here, Miara? What are you doing? Do I need it? No. Does it call me and not let me go? Yes. For how long will I be here? Only he knows.